You offer the first half a line in darkness, don't you?
Yeah, allow me to be frank at the commencement. You will not like me.
That's got to come with it.
It will do. Let's try it again.
Allow me to be frank at the commencement. You will not like me.
And that's great. I think that works lovely.
Nice level of flicker.
Yeah, good level of flicker, I think. Shall we do one?
Shall we?
Yeah. Mark it.
One apple, take one.
Actually,
allow me to be frank at the commencement.
Even though my name is John.
Yes.
You may call me Frank.
Allow me to be frank. Because I have an identity crisis.
Yeah. From an actor's standpoint, when you read that opening monologue and then the ride commences, you know when you're reading that beautiful dialogue and these amazing, these incredible scenes, one after the next, that you'll never, ever see the likes of that again.
The Libertine is the story of the last couple of years of John Wilmot, the second Earl of Rochester's life.
Normally, if you're faced with writing a dramatised biography, you invent a lot of stuff to make it more interesting. With Rochester, it was the other way around. You get from thinking, I have to leave all this stuff out. He's so much.
If someone is extraordinarily talented, they almost always can get away with murder if they choose to.
Obviously, he had great, great talent. But what stands out more than anything was his courage to be absolutely honest.
Nobody writes like Rochester. Nobody wrote before him like that. Nobody really writes in the same vein about sexuality until the 20th century.
Much wine had passed with grave discourse of who fucks who and who does worse. When I, who still take care to see drunkenness relieved by lechery.
He was a poet, an artist, a revolutionary of his day, and if he were alive today, he'd be certainly very rock and roll.
Rochester's inspiration was to get him through two or three bottles of wine, and there's a point where he probably becomes too drunk to write, and the inspiration is over. You can follow Rochester's career by following the drink. You can see what happens when he's drinking a lot, and what happens the rare occasions when he stops drinking.
Why? How did he arrive there, you know? How did he arrive at that need for such excess and that need for self-medication, because I don't think it was about fun for him.
Handsome, brilliant mind, writes wonderfully, had immense talent and deliberately set out not to make the best of his talent. It's a resounding no to life.
But as with those sort of magical, shortened lives, there is an incredible presence.
So yeah, my angle was really ultimately an attempt at understanding the guy and then, you know, trying to do my best to please him, you know. So it was ultimately, it was kind of a love letter to him. You know, hopefully it comes off that way. We'll see.
Out of Joint did the play. It opened in 1994, then was on at the Royal Court that winter, 1994 to 95, and it did very well. It might have rested there, but some guys came over from Steppenwolf Theatre Company in Chicago to see the last performance. They were looking for a play for John Malkovich to do.
They sent it along to me, and I liked it very much. So we performed it on stage at Steppenwolf.
And halfway through the rehearsals, John sort of sidled up to me and said, hey, Steve, you want to make a movie out of this? And you don't say no in those situations.
I was going to direct it, probably, and we had Johnny Depp to come out and see it, see if he wanted to do it.
Because he played it so beautifully on stage, I asked if, you know, why didn't he play the role on screen? And, I think his answer was something, you know, very simply sort of, well, you know, because I want you to do it. I'd like you to do it. And I said, I'm in.
We wanted to make it without a studio involved, and so we went to cobble together the money independently. And it went really well for a really short time.
For sort of catholicity of reasons, it fell apart, so I kind of bagged it.
With films, there's a certain momentum, and once something goes wrong, they start to fall apart very rapidly. And to get the momentum up going again takes months or even years.
Had we shot the film back then in 96, 97, 98, it might have been okay, but I don't know that I was ready or that I could have understood so much of Rochester.
And then 2 years ago, John did this commercial. He came back and said, just did a commercial with his director. He's the best director I worked with in 10 years. And Leanne and I were like, yeah, all right. I'm glad he had a good time. He said, well, no, you got to send him a couple of scripts. And I'm like, oh, Christ.
In 2001, I was in California, and I got an email from Russ Smith, the producer, which said, re-lib. And I thought, Lib, what is that? I didn't recognize it. And he said he'd just met this director called Lawrence Dunmore. Once Lawrence came on board, that put some new energy into the project. Lawrence has been like a terrier. He's grabbed this bone, dug his teeth in, and hasn't let go.
So he jumped into it in the way that Lawrence does, and he and Stephen began to collaborate.
Stephen, who is an absolutely phenomenal genius of a writer, had to endure my, what I would call, sort of C-rate movie approach.
He has an incredible eye, Lawrence, an incredible way of seeing things in pictures.
To work with somebody of Stephen's caliber was incredibly inspiring, so much so that I then spent the next sort of year in between trying to get The Libertine off the ground, writing my own screenplays, which I can safely say are possibly the worst things I've ever read. And I wouldn't expect a small child to draw on the back of them.
But it wasn't an easy film to put together, no. Mm.
In a curious way, if you're waiting for a movie to be made for 7 years, the only way you can survive that is actually by editing out the emotional highs and, you know, the lows, like when the Inland Revenue suddenly changed the regulations.
I mean, the incentives that we have in the UK for the making of films and their finance through the tax funds had resulted in there being a loophole that was being abused. The government reacted very suddenly to that.
Obviously what got up everybody's noses was not the fact that they closed the loophole, but the speed at which they did it.
Poof! One day they decided it was they're going to withdraw everything that they promised for over a year.
When it happened, we were 2 weeks into the build of this set on a stage in Bray. All the steelwork was up, 60 tons of steel.
Stage?
The whole stage had been built.
Jude Law's movie had been canceled. A lot of films were just dropping.
Every one of them, on one particular day, lost 30% of their funding. We have to do something serious and quick, or else we're dead.
Put it this way, I think, you know, everybody across the board who is involved in this production put their hands in their own pockets.
We had to, within 3 weeks, come up with 35% of our budget.
They worked, you know, basically their bollocks off.
Our start date was March the 3rd, and that was set in concrete. We could not change that because we only had Johnny Depp for a certain amount of time.
By the time we got to about the Thursday, I remember going home and calling a friend, just going, actually, I don't think I'm going to do this job, and I'm absolutely gutted.
We called the crew in and had a big meeting and basically said, we're going to pull through this.
And we were saved at the end of the day by the hard work of the producers and by an amazing bunch of people, the Isle of Man.
The Isle of Woe, man.
By the time we had the meeting, they had already gotten approval from the Isle of Man Treasury.
You know, it meant us having to undo 2 weeks of work in the studio here.
Once that sort of initial panic
adrenaline
went through the department, it was like, yeah, we can do it. We're going to make this work. It
seemed like just an impossibility. But hey, they did it.
What was his name?
He's
Johnny,
out.
Johnny,
he's,
is he here? Johnny?
John.
Johnny Depp.
I was Johnny Depp, yeah. I was watching on plane coming back. I'd just come back from America. And he was on his that Caribbean thing.
Green card and Johnny Depp. Yeah.
To Johnny, the most important things are not commercially based. They're to do with the fundamental things of life, which is about people.
You can look at his face for a minute and it's never doing the same thing twice in all that time. He's just this ability to convey deep feeling and what's going on in his head through his eyes and his mouth and tiny movements of the face. And I think that's the most incredible skill.
And I think as an actor, you have to constantly test yourself or push yourself to go places that you maybe you're scared to go to, or places that you haven't wanted to go to. It's a, you know, I think you have to put yourself in a situation where you go, I could fail miserably. I felt myself there, but I felt myself there, you know, in a lot of things I've done, and I think it's a good thing.
I'm not impressed. It has taken you 6 months to find me.
Do you think in 6 months I've given you more than 5 minutes thought?
John, John, sorry. Well, the thing is, if Johnny ever decided to turn up on time, we'd be doing something...
Who?
That, you know...
Depp. Oh, yeah. Yeah, well, he's like that.
But John is an actor who attracts actors. He's a producer who attracts investment. He's a human being who commands attention.
The most advanced scientific instrument in Western Europe. It costs £60,000. It tells the time in every corner of the globe. The man who did that was not continually pissed for the last 3 years.
When you have the opportunity to work with not just Johnny and John, but the likes of Samantha, who is such an incredible actress, you realise that the door of the sweetie shop has been open and closed behind you, and there's nobody to stop you plundering whatever you want.
Ask yourself what you want from the theatre.
I want the passionate love of my audience. I want, when I make a sweep of my arm, to carry their hearts away, and for when I die, for them to sigh for never seeing me again. Till the next afternoon.
My part was just a slice of a pie, and that felt great, you know, to have that collaboration with everybody from the focus puller to the extras, to the DP, to the director. I mean, we were all in there sort of swinging at the same beast and fighting for what was right.
We had a palette that we created that I worked in conjunction with Alex Melman, the DP, with Ben Van Os, with Dean Van Schralen, and with Peter Owen on hair and makeup.
I've loved, you know, the art department here as well, and what they've created, I've been really, really thrilled with. It doesn't feel like your normal costume drama. Everything's a costume drama though, isn't it? Because ultimately, as an actor, you're putting on a costume. They're not your clothes, unless the film's really skint and you're wearing your own jeans, but ultimately, it's a costume.
I think a good crew is absolutely critical, and a good mix of people.
Of course, someone who's had a huge influence on the film is Mary Selway, who sadly died last week, and she did a fantastic job in making sure that every single part was cast absolutely accurate, because even if you're taking up, you know, 10 seconds of film time, it has to be the right person doing it.
I got a call from Mary Selway. I don't know how, a friend of hers saw a show at school, and I was asked to come back and read for the part with two other actors who I didn't know who they were going to be. I turn up and there's Tom Hollander and Johnny Vegas.
Rupert I wasn't sure of from the start, and I'm still not.
Because he's too handsome?
No, there's something of the night of that lad.
Apparently they were auditioning as well. I went back to rehearsal and got an answer phone message in the break from Mary saying please call me about an hour later. And I did that, and she said, Lawrence would like to offer you the job. And I, you know, shat my pants and just said shit a lot to Mary Selway, who I didn't know how important she was at all. I didn't know anything about anything.
I think with a sword in his hand, it may be just better that he kind of really gives him a...
Okay. I think it's just to get it as red or as red as possible as
last
night.
Just to get it off,
So you
and
give him a...
It's not an intentional... Like,
coming in and... And you'll go back down with him onto the ground.
And the high point has been the scenes where we improvised. You know, where he's just let us make things up as Rochester and Alcock, those scenes. That's been the highlight. So I love doing that.
Ink! Bring me ink! Not drink, lump. Ink.
Fear. Is this a pineapple, my lord?
No, Alcock. It's an arse plug. Formerly the king's.
Can I borrow it?
From securing funds, to securing stars, to securing script, to securing the right crew, the right people, and making that all come together at the same time, was probably the biggest part of the actual production of the film. But ultimately ended on that morning of March the 3rd, 2004, knee-deep in mud in Wales.
When is the nearest pub, and anybody got any front money?
I was on the first day of the filming. We were in Wales filming in this ancient, beautiful, medieval little site. It's medieval, right?
Waking up that morning, the crowd, the mud.
I think this kid gets stuck in the mud, his shoes keep coming off.
Putting that camera on my shoulder for the first time.
Oh, look at that, perfect.
I've got nervous ready. I want to do a rehearsal with everything moving just at the same time, just so I can see how it all works.
It was quite phenomenal, you know, almost surreal that it was happening.
Get on the stage and do all the bendo stuff on my first day, surrounded by like a couple of hundred extras, and all the producers were out, you know, on the first day. We're making a movie!
Turn over, IMV camera!
And 91 Charlie, take 5A camera.
B camera!
Ladies and gents, gather near. Listen well. I got a doctor's cure to sell.
Please don't talk, please don't talk.
Hey, Luca!
Questo vino su suona sinos. Ti faccio un culo come le catane. Vieni, mini. Ciacciacine. Move it!
It's amazing. I turned around and suddenly realized my beard was on fire.
Johnny.
Okay, yeah?
Terribly sorry, love.
The shit I can't deal with. The shit everywhere. I don't mind the 17th century, it's just the shit.
It's the chickens trying to upstage you.
Fuck, I had a conversation with the chicken, he answered me back.
Yeah, I'm in a movie, I'm dressed up like a complete mad woman, and I'm in Wales, and there's Johnny Depp. It's cool. It was great.
Well, I just want to thank all of you for such a wonderful birthday present at the best day. Fourth best day of my life. Two children being
kids,
born.
Kids. You can't gotta, beat gotta that. Have kids yeah. Married.
Getting married to my wife.
Uh-huh.
Can't beat that.
And today, that's pretty good for.
Yeah, that's not bad.
I wanted this film to be swamped with mud and smoke and mists and rain.
Help him out with him! Whoa! Fuck, man!
Okay, we gotta go one more time, I'm afraid, guys.
It was really down in the dirt, you know. You got in there and got it done, and it beat you up.
You swore! You swore!
Initially, there was a sort of question in my mind about how stylized the film should be, or how real, and the methods of capturing what we had to shoot.
Just a general dirty air of filth, depravity.
You to be able to literally smell the film. And I wasn't going to do that if I made it too fantastical.
Fuck the world. It's just punk rock.
Yeah.
They want to light this film predominantly with candlelight. And although we do have two standby props and a standby candle prop, I'm still concerned that there will be times when they'll be waiting for us. Just replacing them and relighting them takes time.
I am Candleman. You want to see some hot candle action? Wicks. They're in there. They're not on the floor. Big flame, little flame. And snip. Oh, yeah.
It'd be more an exercise of taking light away rather than lighting things. But here, because we're working right down on the bottom end of what the film is capable of, there are times when, I guess, by normal standards, what we are shooting would be considered unacceptable.
You know, like some people say, some people are a people's director, some people, they're an actor's director. He's really good with candles.
This is fake Hampton Court. This is a car park in the Isle of Man. And the Lawrence Dunmore theory is, if there's enough smoke, it's going to look pretty much like you made Hampton Court look.
I regret the deed's honesty, my lord.
But I considered that if I performed it and fell into your service, I would have more enjoyment of life.
In the end, in Dunmore aesthetics, any location can be turned into any other location because you can't see anything anyway.
I think we all share some snout issues. I just want everyone to know this is not a magic trick. There's nothing up my sleeve, as I have none. Everyone, 3, 2, 1. Like I said earlier, that's why they call it show business and not show fun.
We didn't want it to look like a Merchant Ivory film. We had so much to do in our sort of 9-week shooting schedule that we didn't really have time to overly analyze everything. And that's where I very early on decided that, being the control freak that I am, that I would put the camera on my shoulder and operate that way.
Which gives it a kind of natural, slightly documentary style look. Also means we can work a lot faster. You know, it keeps a kind of looseness, it keeps an energy going, and it becomes more about the performance rather than about the camera.
Come. Cut.
Did you say cut? Well, fuck you.
Oh, yeah. You know what we're doing is, operators are highly trained to operate. We're almost anti-operating. We're kind of trying to break the conventions that an operator would try and impose on us. Just kind of mash it all up a little bit, make it a little bit more anarchic.
You know, we had this approach that we had to take a sometimes 100-strong commando force in, quick hit, get out, and on to the next mission.
We shot this thing in 45 days, and we got in there and just beat it with a stick.
Everything's moved very fast. That was the impression on the first day. You know, Lawrence has done his communicating in a kind of private way, takes you off into a corner and kind of describe to you little hints about what the place is going to look like and what might happen in the scene. Mm-hmm. And he doesn't let you run it through with the other actor. You felt a bit like a racehorse in a box waiting to be kind of let out on the track. And you don't know quite what's going to happen because you have no experience of it. And I find that exciting.
And pull away, Clive. Turn over!
You abducted me in a coach like this when I was still a virgin heiress.
And did you like abduction?
Passionately.
Tell Max I want to wild track this as soon as we've done it. Please.
A wild track is a line of dialogue or a word which we can replace the original word with if for some technical reason it wasn't usable, like if there's a smoke machine or if there's an explosion. We can always replace that little bit of dialogue.
It dazzles the mind. Do you see what can be done with knowledge and application?
Well, I think the problem is they built Hampton Court far too near Heathrow. A lovely building like that next to an airport. It's difficult anywhere shooting in London, and even outside London we're bugged by aeroplanes and stuff, and only Shane McGowan quieting them.
London, you're a lady. Your streets run red with blood, my darling. I have used you and covered you with mud. Your dresses have vanished away to France and down to town. He's fucked up at once. Anyone with a sickness can't be the king's friend. It's time Johnny was cured by Dr. Spendall.
Very good.
I'm often called on to give advice on lenses and various technical questions.
What are they doing?
Oh, they don't need to.
We don't need sound on a plate.
Filming. It's a technique developed similar to the one you're using now, where they have an image they wish to capture on film, sometimes with moving objects, and they point the camera to whereabouts they want to capture that certain image. It comes from the Latin. Camera, to capture life, moving or still.
It is a good thing if a novelty let John devote himself to the house. I will not hear him reproved for it.
I understood that he was devoting himself to an engagement in the theatre.
That would not be appropriate for a man of breeding.
It's kind of like that remark which I think Dylan Thomas made, is that if something good's happened, then you have a drink to celebrate it, and if something's bad happened, you have a drink to get over it, and if nothing's happened, you have a drink to make something happen. And the theatre for him was a kind of release. His imagination could take wing in the playhouse.
I wish to be moved. I cannot feel in life. I must have others do it for me here in the theatre.
As Barry to succeed, not as any part of a project to make himself seem more important, but in order that the theatre was really exciting. He wanted the theatre to be as exciting as it could be.
We've all got limits to what we'll accept in relationships or what we'll allow somebody to teach us. These are two people that push that to the wire. Rochester and Barry push that to the wire, to right to the edge.
I shall never forgive you for teaching me to love life.
If I taught you that, then our account is settled. Your lesson to me was my livelihood, and mine to you was life itself. We have no need to meet again.
One of the things I've relished most is what people have discovered underneath what you've written. The way that actors are so good at mining the subtext and finding out what is the feeling behind the feeling. What's the thought underneath the thought, and making that manifest, making that visible.
Film is about capturing invisible things, which are emotions. You can't say that's matter. That, you know, there it is. There's an emotion for you. Let's put that. It's in the air.
32 French, take four.
And track and action.
Mr. Huysmans. Perhaps a bottle and a glass would be handsome adornments to your composition.
They are not appropriate objects in family bottles,
my lord. Mr. Huysmans, here is another thought. Do you see that monkey yonder dancing to the fiddle? You can't have failed to notice how human these creatures are. I would sit that monkey on a pile of solemn volumes and place in her hand a scrap of paper, as if it were a poem she'd just written, do you see? And while she is offering me the poem, I and crowning her with the bays. We sit here in our finery so that our grandchildren can show us off to strangers. Does not tell the truth. In this portrait, I am no better than a monkey who knows the names of his ancestors.
And I?
A gaudy female monkey gloating over the opulence of your cage.
It's all about a box. It's about putting things in a box. You've got this area, yeah, and it's just put things in it in a nice way. How's that?
Well, it's all about moment, isn't it? You've got to capture the moment.
The process for me is everything. That's why I do it. I like the process of creating something. Yeah, it keeps me moving, keeps me thinking, keeps me stimulated, keeps me alive. Long, long way from, you know, sitting with John Malkovich in Chicago in some restaurant saying, yeah, I'd love to do it, to suddenly you're standing there almost 10 years later, and you realize what you've gotten yourself into. Sure, there's some humor in it, sure, there's some of this, there's some of that, but you've gotten yourself into something where you've made a serious commitment, and you now have a very serious responsibility to this guy, and you got to dig down deep, and you got to get a little squirrely here and there and go places, you know, don't necessarily enjoy going to, you know.
I must be got into my nightgown.
This is what I envy in you stage people. You make time seem so important. I must change my clothes now. I must make my entrance now. But life is not a succession of urgent nows. It is a listless trickle of why should I?
You're on.
He was a great amateur, Rochester, in all senses of the word. His achievement, his work, was his life itself.
I will say that, you know, having had to swim around in the muck and stuff that where I had to travel for Rochester, yeah, I definitely don't want to have to go back there for a while. I mean, I'd rather not, but, you know, it depends on what comes up.
You just go, oh, my God, how will we ever get the next thing on, or the 18 things after that, or blah, blah, blah. But I think you just keep slogging away.
That's the thing, is that we choose, we're lucky. We make exactly the movies we want to make. And we've done that for 5 years.
It's great.
We just don't do it so easily, but we do it.
There was some serious pressure at times. It still is the most incredible, I was going to say, occupation to have, but it's not an occupation. It's the most incredible life to live, being a filmmaker.
It is the end of the shooting, a normally emotional moment, confusing mixture of feeling, but this occasion it relieves me.
The low point is always saying goodbye. To the crew, certainly, but this party that always knows, like, well, we can always work together again, or I'll see them again, or whatever. That's all fine. But the saying goodbye to the guy that the character you've played. You've known him and been him for a good length of time, a good chunk of time, and then suddenly one day you have to say, you know, it's done, and that's hard. That was really hard.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, I'm happy to say that is the end of 29 on my watch, which I have the money on, so I actually win the rap time. Thank you all very much indeed. Well done, everybody. Thank you. One last thing, everybody, and I know everybody isn't here, but this film was very much inspired by a very special lady who was buried today, called Mary Selway. So a little moment for Mary, who was very important to us making this movie.
But The Libertine, man. What a film. If it's half as good as the process to get there, then it'll be okay.
Is that where it ends, Andy?